Hi, I'm Colin G. West. Some science facts are so cool that once you learn them, you can't unthink them. Next time you're about to play a game of cards, I bet you're going to think about this. Want to see a card trick? Here. Pick a card, any card. Let's say this one right here. Now, if I can tell you what this card was, would you be impressed? Come on, you shouldn't be. I've been sitting here preparing to make this video all night. I just looked at the card right before I turned the camera on. It's a two of diamonds. See? Now, if I'd done that same trick after a good shuffle, that would have been pretty cool. But of course, that raises an important question. What makes the difference between a shuffle and a good shuffle? Well, you know what we're all about here. Let's see what math and science has to say about the question. Ideally, after a good shuffle, the card should be in a completely random state. Let's be more specific. That means if I deal a card from someplace in the deck, I should have absolutely no information about what that card is, because all the possibilities should be equally likely. But let's look at how people shuffle in the real world. They cut the deck into two halves, and then they randomly riffle those halves together and square them back up. Now, does a shuffle like this really achieve our goal of a randomized deck of cards? It turns out, not as much as you might think. To see an example of this, suppose that I'm dealing a hand of poker, and for some reason using the world's ugliest tablecloth to do it. Let's say it's a really exciting hand, with lots of kings and aces coming out on the board, and then even more high cards showing up at showdown. Cool hand, for sure. But now I have to prepare to shuffle for the next one. What might happen is that I'll end up gathering together all the aces and kings and putting them on the bottom of the deck. When I cut the deck in half to do the shuffle, they'll end up in my left hand, and then there'll be some of the first cards to drop as I do the riffle, with the rest falling on top. The result is that even after the shuffle, the aces and kings are going to be concentrated towards the bottom of the deck, just not quite as much as before. But this means that the deck still isn't really random. It's not true that I have no idea what card is coming next. I may not know what I am going to get, but I know something about what isn't likely to turn up. Aces and kings, they're on the bottom. Of course, this was an extreme example, but it illustrates the way that anything that happened in the previous hand can affect the structure of the deck before the shuffle. And patterns that are in the deck before the shuffle can give you information about the order of the deck. A single shuffle can dilute this information, but it can't get rid of it entirely. Now, maybe this won't come as a shock to you. After all, most people shuffle more than once when they play a game of cards. But how many times is enough? Well, this is where the real math comes in. Mathematicians and scientists actually care quite a bit about understanding shuffling, because understanding randomness in a familiar context, like a deck of playing cards, helps us understand randomness in more challenging contexts, like computer models of the entire global economy. It's important stuff. So lo and behold, in 1990, a pair of researchers came up with one of the first real equations to model the effectiveness of a riffle shuffle. And since then, a number of different studies have been done, all giving essentially the same results. Here are some figures from a study that I particularly like, because it uses a favorite topic of mine called information theory. Basically, these guys computed how much of the information about the patterns in a deck is destroyed by a single shuffle. It turns out it's just 23%. Additional shuffles will help, but it's not really until you get up around 6 to 8 shuffles that you can say you've gotten rid of almost all the information. Now, 6 to 8 shuffles might sound excessive, especially in the context of a casual game with your friends, where the difference between perfectly random and pretty random is likely to go unnoticed. But we actually know from experience that at an elite level, the world's best card players can tell the difference, and it's important. Consider bridge. No, not that bridge. This bridge. That one card game that your grandparents are always going on about. In the 1970s, the top-level tournaments began replacing shuffling with computer programs to randomize the decks, and the elite players quickly began to complain that there had to be a bug in the code. Their finely honed intuition told them that something was amiss. Certain hands that they expected to be quite common had become very scarce, and vice versa. But there wasn't a problem with the computers, there was a problem with their intuition. It had been honed by years and decades of playing in tournaments with human beings doing the shuffling, and they'd only shuffle 3 or 4 times. After a hand had been played and the cards were gathered back up, the remaining patterns were throwing off the fundamental probabilities of the game, so much so that when the players encountered true randomness for the first time, it came as a shock. But we've been talking a lot about the weaknesses in shuffling. Let's be fair and talk about the incredible strength it can have if it's done right. If a deck of cards is completely shuffled, there should be no way of predicting the order, so there are 52 different possible cards that could be found on the top of the deck. Once we see what's there, there are 51 other cards that could turn up second from the top, 50 cards that could turn up third, and so on and so forth. If we multiply these numbers together, what we get is the total number of possible ways that a random deck of cards could be arranged. It turns out that this is an enormous number. Actually, calling it enormous is an understatement. This number makes enormous numbers look pathetic by comparison. Even to just write it down requires 68 digits. And let's put that in perspective. You know that enormous national debt of ours everyone's always worrying about? Yeah, here's the number of ways the cards in a deck can be arranged. And here's the current estimate of our national debt. It's not even close. It's not even close to close. In fact, there are so many ways of arranging the cards in a deck that after giving one a full and complete set of shuffles, the odds are overwhelmingly high that no human in the history of mankind has ever held a deck in the exact same order as yours. If anything, that statement doesn't go far enough. Even if every star in the sky were somehow teeming with extraterrestrial gin rummy enthusiasts, all it would take was 7 or 8 good shuffles to produce a deck that no being had ever beheld in the history of the universe. I think you got to admit, that's pretty cool. So look, what's the bottom line? Do you need to shuffle the cards 7 times whenever you want to play with them? Probably not. Unless your friends are real sticklers for randomness or you're hosting an elite level bridge tournament. But you definitely want more than 1 or 2 good shuffles, and the more, the better. Sure, it slows down the game a little bit. But what do you care? You're still hanging out and having fun with your friends. And if one of them does complain that it's taking too long, I say tell him to chill out. It's worth the wait. After all, they're about to witness intergalactic history being made. So that's it for this week. If you enjoyed the show, subscribe to the channel for more science thoughts you can't unthink. Thanks to all of you who subscribed so far. If there's a part of your day you'd like to spice up with some more science, tweet it at me with the hashtag #WhatShouldIThinkAboutWhen. You can find me on Twitter at Collins U. West, because I am Collins U. West. And this is Phoebes. Hi, Phoebes. Oh boy. You can find me on Twitter at Collins U. West, because I am Collins U. West. I'll see you next time. Thanks for watching. All right, if you're still watching at this point, it has to be because you thought I was eventually going to do a card trick, right? But I told you, there's no trick. All I did was look through the deck to make sure that everything seemed normal, and then I gave it a quick shuffle for randomness, and then all I had to do was memorize the order that the cards were in so that when you picked a card, I could tell from the number which one it was. I know that probably sounds intimidating and difficult, but it's not so bad when so many of the cards are the 2 of diamonds.